Hello everyone, this is Alka Sharma. Today we are going to discuss on investment analysis and portfolio management module 2. That is all related about risk return relationship. Hello everybody, today we are going to discuss on BMS semester 5th subject, that is investment analysis and portfolio management. Module 2. This module is all about risk-return relationship. So module 2, it's risk-return relationship. So it covers many types of risks, systematic and unsystematic risk in detailed manner, measurement of beta, standard deviation, variance, and the next one is reduction of risk through diversification, and the last one, it's having a practical problems also. The practical problems on calculation of standard deviation, variance and beta. So this all topics covers in module 2, investment analysis and portfolio management. Now what is meaning? Today most students of financial management would agree that the treatment of risk is the main element in financial decision making. Key current question involved, how risk should be measured and how the required return associated with a given risk level is determined. So a person makes an investment in the expectation of getting some return in the future, but the future is uncertain, that is not definite, and so is the future expected return. It is the uncertainty associated with the returns from an investment that introducing risk for an investors. It is important here to distinguish between expected return and realized return from an investment. The expected future return is what an investor expects to get from his investment and is uncertain. On the other hand, the realized return is what an investor actually obtains from his investment at the end of the investment period. The investor makes the investment decision based on the expected return from the investment. So basically the investor focuses on expected return. However, the actual return realized from the investment may not correspond to the expected return. This possible variation of the actual return from the expected return is termed as risk. The actual realization corresponds to expected exactly, there would be no risk. Risk arises when there is a possibility of variation between expectation and realization with regard to an investment. Thus, risk arises from the variability in returns. An investment whose returns are fairly stable is considered to be a low risk investment, whereas an investment whose returns fluctuating significantly is considered to be a highly risk investment. So government securities like treasury bills, T-bills, whose returns are fairly stable and which are from default are considered to possess low risk investment, whereas equity share whose returns are likely to fluctuate widely around their mean are considered risky investment. So the essence of risk in an investment is the variation in its returns. This variation in returns is caused by a number of factors. These factors which produce variations in the returns from an investment constitute the element of risk. So this is all about introduction of risk. Now, what is risk? In finance, risk is the probability that actual result will differ from expected result. In the capital asset pricing model that we will talk in further videos, risk is defined as volatility of returns. The concept of risk and return is that riskier assets should have higher expected return to compensate investors for the higher volatility with increased risk. Now, types of risk. Broadly speaking, there are two main categories of risk. First one is systematic risk and second one is unsystematic risk. Now, the first one, systematic risk, is the market uncertainty of an investment. It's meaning that it represents external factors that impact all or many companies in an industry or group. Now, second one is unsystematic risk, represent the asset-specific uncertainties that can affect the performance of an investment. Below is a list of the important types of risk for a financial analyst to consider when evaluating investment opportunities. Now, systematic risk, the overall impact of the market. Unsystematic risk, asset specific or company specific uncertainty. Next is political regulatory risk, the impact of political decision and changes in regulation. Next is financial risk, the capital structure of a company, degree of financial leverage or debt burden. Interest rate risk, the impact of changing interest rates. Next is country risk, the uncertainties that are specific to a country. Next one is social risk, the impact of changes in social norms, movements and unrest. Next one is environmental risk, uncertainty about environmental liabilities or the impact of changes in the environment. Next is operational risk, uncertainty about a company's operation including its supply chain and the delivery of its product or services. Next one, management risk, the impact that the decisions of management team have on a company. Next is legal risk, uncertainty related to lawsuits or the freedom to operate. And the next one, the degree of competition in an industry and the impact of choices of competitors will have on a company. So this is all about types of risk. Now, element of risk. Let us consider the risk in holding securities such as shares, debentures, etc. The elements of risk may be broadly classified into two groups as shown in the following. The first group, that is systematic risk, comprises factors that are external to a company, or we can say macro in nature, and affect a large number of securities simultaneously. These are mostly uncontrollable. We can't control in nature. The second group is unsystematic risk, includes those factors which are internal to companies and it is micro in nature and affect only those particular companies. These are controllable to a great extent. The total variability in returns of a security is due to the total risk of that security. Hence, total risk is equals to systematic risk plus unsystematic risk. Now, detail about systematic risk. Due to dynamic nature of society, the changes occurs in the economic, political and social system constantly. These changes have an influence on the performance of companies and thereby on their stock prices, but in varying degrees. For example, economic and political instability adversely affects all industries and companies. When an economy moves into recession, corporate profits will shift downwards, and stock prices of most companies may also decline. Thus, the impact of economic, political, and social changes in system-wide and that portion of total variability in security returns caused by such system-wide factors is referred to as systematic risk. Systematic risk can be further subdivided into interest rate risk, market risk, and purchasing power risk. Purchasing power risk is also known as inflation risk. The portion of the variability of return of a security that is caused by external factor is called systematic risk. It is also known as market risk or non-diversifiable risk, that is, that cannot be controllable. Economic and political instability, economic recession, macro policy of the government, etc., affect price of all shares systematically. Thus, the variation of return in shares, which is caused by these factors, is called systematic risk. Now, in systematic risk, I told you that interest rate risk. So, what is interest rate risk? This arises due to the variability in interest rates from time to time, and particularly affects debt securities like bonds and debentures, as they carry fixed coupon rate of return. A change in the interest rates establishes an inverse relationship in the price of security. That is, price of security tends to move inversely with changes in rate of interest. Long-term securities show greater variability in the price with respect to interest rate changes than short-term securities. While cash equivalents are less vulnerable to interest rate risk, the long-term bonds are more vulnerable to interest rate risk. Now, next one is purchasing power risk, that I told you it is also known as inflation risk, as it is also emanates from the very fact that inflation affects the purchasing power adversely. Nominal return contains both the real return component and an inflation premium in a transaction involving risk of the above type of compensate for inflation over an investment holding period. Inflation rates vary over time, and investors are caught in unaware when rate of inflation changes unexpectedly, causing erosion in the value of realized rate of return and expected return. So, purchasing power risk is more in inflationary conditions, especially in respect of bonds and fixed income securities. It is not desirable to invest in such securities during inflationary periods. Purchasing power risk is, however, less in flexible income securities like equity shares or common stock, when rise in dividend income offsets increase in the rate of inflation and provides advantage of capital gains. Now, next is market risk. This is a type of systematic risk that affects prices of any particular shares, move up or down consistently for some time periods in line with other shares in the market. A general rise in share prices is refers to a bullish trend, whereas general fall in share prices is refers to as bearish trend. In other words, share market moves between the bullish and bearish phase. The market movements can be easily seen in the movement of shares prices indices such as the BSE Sensitive Index, BSE National Index, NSE Index, etc. Now next one is unsystematic risk in detailed manner. Sometimes the return from a security of any company may vary because of certain factors, particularly to these company. Variability in returns of security on account of these factors, that is micro in nature. It is also known as unsystematic risk, that is diversifiable. It should be that risk is in addition to the systematic risk affecting all companies. The return from a security sometimes varies because of certain factors affecting only the company issuing such security. Examples are raw material scarcity, labor strike, management efficiency, etc. When variability of returns occurs because of such firm specific factors, it is also known as unsystematic risk, or it is also known as diversifiable risk that can be controlled. So unsystematic risk can be further subdivided into business risk and financial risk. Now, what is a business risk? Business risk emanates from sale and purchase of securities affected by business cycles, technology changes, etc. Business cycles affect all types of securities through there is cheerful movement in boom due to bullish trend in stock prices, whereas bearish trend in depression brings down fall of in the prices of all types of securities. So flexible income securities are more affected than fixed income securities. During depression due to decline in their market price. Now next one is financial risk. It arises due to changes in capital structure of the company. It is also known as leveraged risk and expressed in terms of debt equity ratio. Excess of debt vis-a-vis equity in the capital structure indicates that the company is highly geared. Although a leveraged company's earnings per share are more, but dependence on borrowing exposes it to the risk of winding up for its inability to honor its commitments towards lenders, or you can say creditors. This risk is known as leveraged or financial risk, of which investors should be aware of and portfolio managers should be very careful. Reduction of risk through diversification. Now, the next topic of module 2 is reduction of risk through diversification. As discussed above, the total risk of an individual security consists of two risks, systematic risk and unsystematic risk. It should be noted that by combining many securities in a portfolio, the unsystematic risk can be avoided or canceled out, which is attached to any particular security. The following diagram depicts how the risk can be reduced with the increase in the number of securities. So by this we can do reduction of risk through diversification. So the total risk of an individual security comprises two components: the market related risk called systematic risk, and the unique risk of that particular security called unsystematic risk. By combining securities into a portfolio, the unsystematic risk is specific to different securities. is cancelled out. Consequently, the risk of the portfolio as a whole is reduced as the size of portfolio increases. Ultimately, when the size of the portfolio reaches a certain limit, it will contain only systematic risk of securities included in the portfolio. The systematic risk, however, cannot be eliminated. Thus, a fairly large portfolio has only systematic risk and has relatively little unsystematic risk. That is why there is no gain in adding securities to a portfolio beyond a certain portfolio size. Following figures depicts diversification of risk in a portfolio. The figure shows the portfolio risk declining as the number of securities in the portfolio increases. But the risk reduction ceases when unsystematic risk is eliminated. From the above diagram, it can be seen that total risk is reducing with the increase in the number of securities in the portfolio. However, ultimately, when the size of the portfolio reaches to a certain limit, it will contain only the systematic risk of securities included in the portfolio. So, this is all about reduction of risk through diversification. Now, the next topic of Module 2 is variance of portfolio. So, what is the variance of portfolio? It measures the dispersion of average returns in a portfolio from its mean. It tells us about the total risk of the portfolio. It is calculated based on individual variance of the portfolio investments and their mutual correlation. So, variance of individual assets. Variance of an individual investment is calculated using the following steps. First, calculate the arithmetic mean, that is average of the asset returns. Next, find out difference between each return value from the mean and square it. Next, sum of all squared deviations and divided it by total number of observations. So let us say an investment generated a return of 2%, 3%, 4% in 3 months. The arithmetic mean of returns equal 3 months. So, for calculating the variance of portfolio, first we need to find out the arithmetic mean, that is denoted by mu. So, for this, 2% plus 3% plus 4% divided by 3 is equals to 3%. That means sum of 9 divided by 3. So by cancelling, we get 3. That is equal to 3%. Now next is sum of square deviation is 0.02%. For this sum of square deviation, what we will do? We will calculate it by 2% minus 3%. 3% is for arithmetic mean. So 2 minus 3% plus 3 minus 3% plus 4 minus 3% is equal to 0.02%. So this is sum of square deviation. Now the variance of individual investment equals 0.006%. How it is calculated? We know that sigma square is represented as variance. So for this, 0.02% divided by 3 is equals to 0.0067%. So the variance is equals to sum of square deviation upon number of securities. In previous slide, we have done how to calculate variance of individual asset. Now I will tell you how to calculate the variance of a portfolio. For calculation of a variance of a portfolio, we need a matrix of mutual correlation of all the constituent assets of the portfolio called correlation matrix. The exact formula differs depending on the number of assets in the portfolio. So here, in case of two asset portfolio, the formula is just like, we can work out portfolio variance as follows. So variance will be denoted by a sigma. At two assets portfolio, we can work out portfolio variance as follows. The formula is sigma square is equals to W12 square sigma 12 square plus W2 square sigma 2 square plus W1 W2 covariance 12, where W1 is a weight of first asset, W2 is a weight of second asset, sigma 12 square is variance of first asset, and sigma 2 square is a variance of second asset, and covariance 12 shows covariance of two assets. Since covariance equals the product of correlation coefficient and standard deviation of each asset, we can rewrite the always equation as follows. Sigma square is equals to W1 square sigma 12 square plus W2 square sigma 2 square plus 2W1 W2 sigma 1 sigma 2. Rho is the correlation coefficient of returns of first and second asset. For a three asset portfolio, the variance formula is as follows. Sigma square is equals to W1 square sigma 1 square plus W2 square sigma 2 square plus W3 square sigma 3 square plus 2W1 W2 sigma 1 sigma 2 rho 1 plus 2W2 W3 sigma 2 sigma 3 rho 2 3, plus 2W1 W3 sigma 1 sigma 3 rho 1 3. So this is the formula of three asset variance of portfolio. Now we calculate, we can understand how to calculate variance of portfolio. The illustration: diversification benefits in a portfolio of three investment. First one is a stock A, a bond B, and a real estate C. The asset weights are 20%, 35%, and 45% respectively. Their standard deviations are 2.3%. The correlation coefficient between A and B is 0.6, between A and C is 0.8, and between B and C is 0.5. We need to work out the variance of the portfolio as follows. The sigma square is... So in this example, you can see that the weights are W1 is equals to 20%, W2 is equals to 35%, W3 is equals to 45%, and standard deviation is sigma 1 is equals to 2.3%, sigma 2 is equals to 3.5%, and sigma 3 is equals to 4%. And the correlation coefficient that represent rho AB is equals to 0.6, AC is equals to 0.8, and between B and C is 0.5. So as I told you, the formula of variance of portfolio of three asset, because here is the portfolio of three investment. So we just put the formula. Sigma square is equals to W1 square sigma 1 square plus W2 square plus sigma 2 square plus W3 square plus sigma 3 square plus W1 W2 rho 1 rho 2 sigma 1 sigma 2 rho 1 2 plus W2 W3 sigma 2 sigma 3 rho 2 3 plus 2W1 W3 rho 1 rho 3 sigma 1 sigma 3 and rho 1 3. So here we just substitute the value and find out the result. As I told you, the variance of portfolio of three assets. So here we just apply the formula of variance of three assets. So sigma square represent as a variance. We just substitute the value. Sigma square is equals to 20 square into 2.3 square plus 35 square into 3.5 square plus 45 square into 4 square plus 2 into 20% into 35% into 2.3% into 3.5% into 0.6 plus 2 into 35% into 45% into 3.5% into 4% into 0.5 plus 2 into 20% into 45% into 2.3% into 4% into 0.8. So by calculating this, we will get the answer is 0.0916%. So this is the variance of portfolio of three assets. The value of portfolio is 0.0916%. Volatility is best measured using standard deviation, which can be calculated as, I told you, sigma square is equals to variance. But standard deviation is square root of sigma square. So it becomes sigma. So sigma is a standard deviation. So how we calculate it here? 0.0916% square root is equals to, we will get the answer 3.03%. Portfolio standard deviation refers to the volatility of portfolio, which is calculated based on three important factors that include the standard deviation of each of the asset present in the total portfolio, the respective weight of that individual asset in total portfolio, and correlation between each pair of assets of the portfolio. So interpretation of standard deviation of portfolio, this helps in determining the risk of an investment vis-a-vis the expected return. Portfolio standard deviation is calculated based on the standard deviation of returns of each asset in the portfolio. The proportion of each asset in the overall portfolio, that is their respective weights in the total portfolio, and also correlation between each pair of assets in the portfolio. A high portfolio standard deviation highlights that the portfolio risk is high and return is more volatile in nature and as such unstable as well. A portfolio with low standard deviation implies less volatility and more stability in the returns of portfolio and is a very useful metric when comparing different portfolios. How to calculate portfolio standard deviation? Portfolio standard deviation calculation is multi-step process and involves below mentioned process. The process just like that. Portfolio standard deviation formula. Assuming a portfolio comprises of two assets. First, I will let you know that two assets portfolio deviation formula. Only the standard deviation of two asset portfolio can be computed using portfolio standard deviation formula. Portfolio standard deviation formula is represented by sigma. In variance, it is a sigma square, but here it becomes square root of sigma square. That becomes sigma. So the value of portfolio standard deviation formula is sigma p, that is standard deviation of portfolio, is equals to square root WA square sigma square sigma A square plus WB square sigma B square plus WA WB and sigma A sigma B into correlation coefficient rho. So for standard deviation formula, we first find out the standard deviation of each asset in the portfolio, find the weight of each asset in the overall portfolio, and find the correlation between the assets in the portfolio. So in a given problem, we just find out these three categories and apply that values in the formula and get the answers of standard deviation. Correlation can vary in the range of minus 1 to 1. Apply the values in the above mentioned to derive the standard deviation formula of a two asset portfolio. Now, measurement of beta. Beta is the systematic risk that is known as volatility relative to the market. The beta coefficient in terms of finance and investing describe how the expected return of a stock or portfolio is correlated to the return of the financial market as a whole. The beta coefficient is measure of sensitivity or correlation of a security or an investment portfolio to movements in the overall market. We can derive a statistical measure of risk by comparing the returns of an individual security, or you can say that portfolio, to the returns of the overall market. And it also identifies the proportion of risk that can be attributed to the market. Beta could be positive or negative and combines elements of return, volatility, and direction. The directional aspect of beta is a function of whether the portfolio beta is positive or negative. A positive beta is associated with the tendency of the portfolio to move in the same direction. Okay? A negative beta is associated with the expectation that a portfolio will move in the opposite direction, like this, of the market. A beta close to zero indicates portfolio is not influenced by the market's direction. Interpretation of beta. If we know the value of beta, we can interpret or measure the beta. For beta is equals to 1, the risk associated with the individual stock is same as the risk associated with market portfolio. That is for the beta is equals to 1. Now beta, for beta greater than 1, it shows that the stock has more unavoidable risk as compared to market as a whole. This kind of stock is known as aggressive investment. So it is all about the beta greater than 1. Now the last one is beta less than 1. The stock is less risky as compared to the stock in the market portfolio. This kind of stock is known as defensive investment. This is all about beta less than. The next topic is meaning of beta and how it is measured. The CAPM, I already told you, capital asset pricing model, contains that shares co-move with the market. If the market moves by 1% and a share has a beta of 2, then the return on the share would move by 2%. The beta indicates the sensitivity of return on share with the return on the market. Some company activities are more sensitive to changes in the market. For example, like luxury car manufacturers have high betas, while those relating to goods and services likely to be in demand, irrespective of the economic cycle. Now, for example, food manufacturers have lower betas. The beta value of 1.0 is the benchmark against all share betas are measured. Now, as I already told you, beta's value. So here these also connected. Beta greater than 1, that means aggressive share. Actually, that means these shares tend to go up faster than the market in a rising bull market and fall more than the market in the declining bear market. So that's why it is called aggressive shares. Now, if the value of beta is less than 1, then defensive share. This means that these shares will generally experience smaller than average gains in rising market and smaller than average falls in declining market. That's why it is called defensive shares. Now, if the value of beta is equals to 1, that means it is a neutral share. These shares are expected to follow the market. Okay. Now, the beta value of share is normally between 0 to 0 and 2.5. A risk-free investment, for example, a T-bill, treasury bill, government securities, has beta equal to 0. That means there is no risk. The most risky shares, like some of the more questionable penny share investment, would have a beta would value closer to 2.5. Therefore, if you are in the exam and you calculate a beta of 11, you know that you have made a mistake. Okay, got it?